Next up is Benoit Chenu. Did I pronounce that correctly? Okay. He's best known for being the author of G Unicorn, but today he's going to talk about how he ported the Go concurrency model to Python. So please give a warm round of applause to Benoit.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. I'm pleased to meet you and to be there today. I will present you my little journey in concurrent programming with Python and how I finished by experimenting to port the Go concurrency model in Python and the library I wrote for that. So just to quickly to introduce myself, I'm the G Unicorn author, a Whisky web server in Python. I'm also CouchDB core committer and member of the PMC, which is the project management group of the CouchDB. I'm a Python Foundation fellow member, and I'm doing open source for a living. So first, what is concurrent programming? Basically, concurrent programming is a way to run function simultaneously, but it doesn't mean formally in parallel. It doesn't have to be in parallel. It could be just running your function execute code simultaneously by sharing your process in multiple time slices on which you will run from time to time a part of the code you want to execute. Or you can run it on multiple CPUs or machines, and then it can be run in parallel in that case. You have mostly two models of concurrency. The first one is a shared memory, which is easier for the programmer. He doesn't have to care about variable. He can use global variable. Variable are passed to functions. And the virtual machine, the runtime, is managing for him. It can be problematic. This is not the more efficient way to run your program concurrently, because the runtime have to care about locks. And when you want to access, for example, to a global variable, the system will have to ask for the latest step of the variable, and then you will have to lock the runtime, check the variable, and pass it to the function, etc. Again, back and forth. And Python is not really efficient for that. And the other way is message passing. So you have two models. You have the actor model and the CSP model. I won't detail it. Then today, this is mostly a way to say my function, my code, is running independently in a part of my process or on the different process on different machine. And I'm passing to them data via message passings. So they can discuss between themselves and exchange data. Erlang and Scala are very well known to handle them. So nowadays in Python, you have different ways to handle that. You have three ways in the standard library. The old way, for example, is using asyncio, which is basically just an improved select. Select allows you to wait on read and write events on your sockets or file descriptors. Asyncio allows you to do that, but you can register a function that will handle some code when an event happened. You have a more primitive way, which are threads in Python. I will come back later on that, but you have many problems with threads in Python. They allows you to run concurrently, but doesn't run in parallel. And are running serially. You have multiprocessing that allows you to launch code on different OS processes and that have the same API as threads. And on top of them, you can use a future, which are now in Python 3, but are available as an extension in Python 2, and that allows you to execute code using a thread of pool or thread of process on top of multiprocessing on threads. And you can execute your code on one thread or one process, and the result, when you come back later in the future, you recover the result of the exceptions you had. And you can also put some callback on that, on the results. You have asyncio, which is a modern way in Python 3, which allows you to do evented and asynchronous programming. Basically allows you to yell to or yell from a generator, and not really like asyncio because It's like you are doing message passing, but because you can send to an iterator or getting back some result from an iterator, but this is not message passing, and this is only running on one frame in your thread. So it just interrupts your code the time you get the data from an iterator or to an iterator, and then you come back on the code. So you can't really run multiple code in the main concurrently. You just interrupt from time to time the code. And it's also running on one thread only. You can also use external library. You have too many groups of external library. The one that are implicitly yieldings and running asynchronous code, blocking code in background. You don't have to care about how it's run your code. It's hidden. You are you are developing your Python code like you usually do. Each function are blockings. You pass a function, get the result, etc., and the code is run in an event loops. G-event, eventlet, evergreen are good library for that, and they are all based on greenlets. They just are using different event loops. For G-event, this is libevent today, and evergreen is using libuv and pyuv. The other group is event library twisted, which is mostly working like AsyncIO, at least it inspired a lot of AsyncIO. And this is, for me, this is like having Node.js somehow on Python, using spaghetti code and waiting for callback, passing for callback, eventually deferring some call for later, but this is not what I really wanted. And all this library, AsyncIO, G-event, eventlet, evergreens, twisted, all are based of event loops, mostly targeting I/O input-output. So files, events, and sockets events, with some options to use the time where your event loop is idling to handle some other code or to handle a timer. So I decided to write a new library for that, so to experiment some new code. I'm basically porting the Go runtime library, the Go runtime to Python. Offset means this is a small and virtual complex data plants, so that is growing on another plant and are sharing the same at the end. They are both sharing the same at the end, but the other plant have its own life. And this is basically what is offset. This is making the Go scheduler on top of Python, Python VM. I have some goals, or sort of. I want a simple blocking API like G-event and eventlet, but that is not trying to patch in background my the standard library. I prefer something explicit. I prefer to know when my library is patched, and I prefer to proxy standard library for that. Based on the concurrency model, so it used to be working on Python 2.7, and it's still working on Python 2.7 and 2.8, 2.7.8, but I'm mostly focusing today on Python 3.4 and PyPy, because I don't have time to handle all the Python today. And you can find it on my repository. The concurrency model is mostly a memory model. It's based on Go routine. Each Go routine are a bunch of code that is running on the one thread. It's basically a way to split your thread to pass function execution code in a stack of your threads in multi-frame. And when you want to switch from one code to the other, the system is choosing one frame in the thread to execute and go back in your code, etc. It's basically just adding a metadata to your threads. Each coroutine does not know from each other. They are running independently from other. You can't pass global variable. Obviously, in Go, you have global variable, but it's not advised to use them. And this is the same in offset. You can use because you are in Python, but I don't advise you to use them because you will have, again, concurrency issue. They don't share anything, and channel pipes are the only way to communicate between them. Also, are a way to unblock your code, because when you are waiting for a channel, the scheduler is able to run again to say if someone will send to the channel or to execute another code, etc. And you can wait on multiple channels. I decided to code that on top of Python because it was easier, but yeah, it was I have some nightmares, so really, I didn't sleep sometimes to find a way. because Python has drawback, and the main drawback is well known, this is a GIL, and the main problem of the GIL is here allows you to make easy code, to have global variable, to easily pass variable to your function, etc. But like I said, to do that, the system is, the runtime is, it need to lock, and it takes time. And also, because of that, one of the OS thread is executed at a time. You may have multi-threads running in parallel in your systems, but you can only handle one thread at a time to execute the code, and then you need to wait at the thread finish to execute to get the results. So during this time, your system is locked. But it works well for IO-bound things like accepting one socket, waiting for connections, reading an event on sockets, or reading a file, writing to a file, because all of that is handled in the background by your OS. So using Flip for that, and I will use for that, is very fine. And yeah, Python has no implementation of the quarantine, and I don't want to try to do that on Yield. I don't think it will work anyway. So I decided to create some coroutines, to create a coroutine systems. Coroutine will always be executed in the same thread, in the main thread, and broken call operations will be executed in their own thread, a Python thread. To implement coroutine, I'm using Python Fiber. Python Fiber is basically a port of continuelets on CPythons from Sagul, Theater of IUV. And I contributed to Python Fibers to also have the same API on top of PyPy, so you can use Python Fiber on top of PyPy too, using the same API. I created a module to do atomic locking, so instead of using mutex, etc. on the system, I'm using atomic operations that you can find on GCC and other implementations, and I've created a CFFI for that. Everything is abstracted in Prost class, so if you want to use greenlets, you can eventually write your own abstraction to build coroutines. So scheduling, so this is the main part of the offset library. There are three entities in the scheduler. The other threads, called F, because they will run in futures, in thread pools. Scheduler context, which is called P, because you have one scheduler context, which we maintain and run queue in the main thread, and this is called P because of process. And this is process in your Python VM. And go routine, which are called T. How the scheduler works is pretty simple, in fact, at the end. You have a process context, which is maintaining a run queue of coroutines, and these coroutines are stacked in a queue, and the first one entered will be the first to be out to be executed. At a time, you have only one coroutine that is running, the one that is put out of the run queue, and when the coroutine has stopped to run, it can be placed, put back in the run queue, or it can be another coroutine from the run queue will be executed. Of course, you still have a syscall, system call to handle any blocking call, like waiting, having a timer, or waiting for connection, or reading a file, any blocking operation, mostly IO operations. So you are still your run queue, and when your coroutine is detected as blocking, and this is done by patching, proxying the standard library in the syscall modules. In offsets, I'm tagging any blocking call from the standard library in the syscall modules. And when a function is detected as blocking, the scheduler will put the goroutine out of the runtime, out of the run queue, and will create a call in the thread pools that will handle the call. So the call, accepting connection or reading a file, will be handled in threads. And when it comes back, the scheduler recreate the goroutine and put it back in the run queue. And it put it back in the on top of the run queue, so it will be executed in priority. And you will get the results in your code later. So by doing that, all your source code are able to run in parallel, and you are still able to handle the rest of the code in your runtime. Some examples. Here is a Go routine example. On the right, you have the Python code. On the left, you have the Go code, which are pretty similar. So what this code is doing is pretty simple. It's putting hello world 5 times. And the first time the main function is executed. So here you are seeing some kind of old code because the run function is about to be removed. I just need to commit the code. But right now, this is how it works. So you have a goroutine that is saying words, and the main function that is saying hello. And the save function, what it's doing is 5 times is printing the string that is passed to it, and is sleeping during 100 milliseconds. And when it's sleeping, this is a syscall function, and when it's sleeping, the goroutine is put back in the run queue, and the next code will be executed. So the first time it would say hello, the main function will be put out will be put back in the run queue, and the next goroutine, which is a world goroutine, the first goroutine will print hello, will be put in the run queue, then the next go routine will be executed, will say hello, et cetera, 5 times. And pretty similar to the Go code modulo the syntax. Channels. So channels are fully implemented in offsets, like in Go. You have all the features you have in Go language, you have them in offsets. Channel are mostly pipes that connect concurrent go routing. You can send value into a channel from one goroutine to the other, and receive those value in another goroutines. And by doing that, when you are sending a value, the goroutine is put back in the run queue to let a chance to another queue, goroutine to send back the data to this goroutine. When the goroutine is sending, it will boot back in the run queue, and the next goroutine will be available. Okay. And you will be able to read. So by doing that, we are mostly articulating the scheduler and unblocking your code by passing message from one goroutine to the other goroutine. Channel can be buffered. That means that you don't have to wait that someone is receiving the first value you are sending. You can send many value at a time. Before blocking your code. And you can select on multiple channels. Here is a simple example. On the right, you have Python. On the right and the left, you have Go again. And we are making a channel. Here, the goal is to sum a list. And to sum the list more efficiently, we will split in two. And we are splitting the list in two. We're creating two goroutines that will sum this list. To this goroutine, we are passing a channel, which is created by the makeChan function. And when the sum is done in the goroutine, it will send back the result in the channel. And the main function is waiting for the result of these two goroutines, getting the result of the sums on x and y, and we sum the final result to print the final sums. And the code in Go is quite similar. This is an example with buffering, and this is an example with the channel. So the channel is the select function, which allows you to wait on multiple channel, and you can wait that someone is able to receive the data you want to send to him, or to wait that someone is able to send you some data that you want to receive. And mostly like a select when you are waiting for read and write in your sockets. And this is done by the if send functions here, and you register some events in the select function. So you are here. We are receiving a send and a receive. And voilà. This is the Fibonacci function. Not time to detail it. You have other models implemented. You have sync function, which are atomic locking that you can use in your library in plus of channels. So you can do some atomic locking. And you have timer and net and IO modules too to handle the IO connection to your file and your sockets in an unblocking manner. What I want to do is to rewrite channel using mmap. This is mostly done. Span on different processes on machine, which needs the first one to be done. Channel and make the runtime switchable, like in Rust, so you can eventually switch to a library runtime if you want, or to use a multiprocessing runtime or any other runtime. Any help is appreciated, and you can also contribute on the repository. Voilà. If you have some questions,
If you have questions, please line up at the microphones. Or raise your hand if you're...
Okay. No?
No questions yet? Okay.
Okay.
Thanks again, Benoit.